Random House Audio presents The Lost Painting by Jonathan Harr. Read for you by Campbell Scott. Part 1. The Englishman. The Englishman moves in a slow but deliberate shuffle, knees slightly bent and feet splayed, as he crosses the piazza, heading in the direction of a restaurant named Da Fortunato. The year is 2001. The Englishman is 91 years old. He carries a cane, the old-fashioned kind, wooden with a hooked handle, although he does not always use it. The dome of his head, smooth as an eggshell, gleams pale in the bright midday Roman sun. He is dressed in his customary manner, a dark blue double-breasted suit, hand-tailored on Savile Row, more than 30 years ago, and a freshly starched white shirt with gold cufflinks and a gold collar pin. His hearing is still sharp, his eyes clear and unclouded. He wears glasses, but then he has worn glasses ever since he was a child. The current pair are tortoiseshell and sit cockeyed on his face, the left earpiece broken at the joint. He has fashioned a temporary repair with tape. The lenses are smudged with his fingerprints. Da Fortunato is located on a small street in the shadow of the Pantheon. There are tables outside, shaded by a canopy of umbrellas, but the Englishman prefers to eat inside. The owner hurries to greet him and addresses him as Sir Dennis, using his English honorific. The waiters all call him Signore Man. He speaks to them in Italian with easy fluency, although with a distinct Etonian accent. Sir Dennis takes a single glass of red wine with lunch. A waiter recommends that he try the grilled porcini mushrooms with Tuscan olive oil and sea salt, and he agrees, smiling and clapping his hands together. "It's the season," he says in a high, bright voice to others at his table, his guests. "They are ever so good now." When in Rome, he always eats at Da Fortunato, if not constrained by invitations to dine elsewhere. He is a man of regular habits. On his many visits to the city, he has always stayed at the Albergo del Senato, in the same corner room on the third floor, with a window that looks out over the great smoke-grayed marble portico of the Pantheon. Back home in London, he lives in the house in which he was born, a large red-brick Victorian townhouse in the quiet, orderly confines of Cadogan Square in Belgravia. He was an only child. He has never married, and he has no direct heirs. His lovers, on this subject he is forever discreet, have long since died. Around the table, the topic of conversation is an artist who lived 400 years ago, named Michelangelo Merisi da Caravaggio. Sir Dennis has studied, nose to the canvas, magnifying glass in hand, every known work by the artist. Since the death of his rival and nemesis, the great Italian art scholar Roberto Longhi, Sir Dennis has been regarded as the world's foremost authority on Caravaggio. Nowadays, younger scholars who claim the painter as their domain will challenge him on this point or that, as he himself had challenged Longhi many years ago. Even so, he is still paid handsome sums by collectors to render his opinion on the authenticity of disputed works. His verdict can mean a gain or loss of a small fortune for his clients. To his great regret, Sir Dennis tells his luncheon companions he's never had the chance to own a painting by Caravaggio. For one thing, fewer than 80 authentic Caravaggios, some would argue no more than 60, are known to exist. Several were destroyed during World War II, and others have simply vanished over the centuries. A genuine Caravaggio rarely comes on the market. Sir Dennis began buying the works of Baroque artists in the 1930s, when the ornate frames commanded higher prices at auction than the paintings themselves. Over the years, he has amassed a virtual museum of Seicento art in his house at Cadogan Square, 79 masterpieces, works by Guercino, Guido Reni, the Caracci brothers, and Domenichino. He bought his last painting in 1964. By then, prices had begun to rise dramatically. After two centuries of disdain and neglect, the great tide of taste had shifted, and before Sir Dennis's eyes, the Italian Baroque had come back into fashion. And no artist of that era had become more fashionable than Caravaggio. Any painting by him, even a small one, would be worth today many times the price of Sir Dennis's finest Guercino. "A Caravaggio? Perhaps now as much as 40-50 million English pounds," he says with a small shrug. "No one can say for certain." He orders a bowl of wild strawberries for dessert. One of his guests asks about the day many years ago when he went in search of a missing Caravaggio. Sir Dennis smiles. The episode began, he recalls, with a disagreement with Roberto Longhi, who in 1951 had mounted the first exhibition in Milan of all known works by Caravaggio. Sir Dennis, then 41 years old and already known for his eye, spent several days at the exhibition, studying the paintings. Among them was a picture of St. John the Baptist as a young boy, from the Roman collection of the Doria Pamphili family. No one had ever questioned its authenticity, but the more Sir Dennis looked at the painting, the more doubtful he became. Later, in the files of the Archivio di Stato in Rome, he came across the trail of another version, one he thought more likely to be the original. He went looking for it one day in the winter of 1952. Most likely it was morning, although he does not recall this with certainty. He walked from his hotel at a brisk pace. He used to walk briskly, he says, through the narrow, cobbled streets still in morning shadow, past ancient buildings with their umber-colored walls, stained and mottled by centuries of smoke and city grime, the shuttered windows flung open to catch the early sun. He would have worn a woolen overcoat against the damp Roman chill, and a hat, a felt fedora, he believes. He dressed back then as he dresses now, a starched white shirt with a high, old-fashioned collar, a tie, a double-breasted suit, although in those days he carried an umbrella instead of the cane. His path took him through a maze of streets, many of which in the years just after the war still lacked street signs. He had no trouble finding his way. Even then he knew the streets of central Rome as well as he knew London's. At the Capitoline Hill, he climbed the long stairway up to the piazza designed by Michelangelo. A friend named Carlo Pietrangeli, the director of the Capitoline Gallery, was waiting for him. They greeted each other in the English way, with handshakes. Sir Dennis does not like being embraced, and throughout his many sojourns in Italy, he has largely managed to avoid the customary greeting of a clasp and a kiss on both cheeks. Pietrangeli told Sir Dennis that he had finally managed to locate the object of his search in, of all places, the office of the mayor of Rome. Before that, the painting had hung for many years in the office of the Inspector General of Belle Arti, in a medieval building on the Via del Portico d'Ottavia, in the ghetto district of the city. The Inspector General had regarded the painting merely as a decorative piece with a nice frame, of no particular value. The original, after all, was at the Doria Pamphili. After the war, Pietrangeli did not know the precise details. Someone had moved it to the Palazzo Senatorio, and finally to the mayor's office. Pietrangeli and Sir Dennis crossed the piazza to the Palazzo Senatorio. The mayor's office lay at the end of a series of dark hallways and antechambers, a spacious room with a high ceiling, and a small balcony that looked out over the ancient ruins of the Imperial Forum. There was no one in the office. Sir Dennis spotted the painting hanging high on a wall. He remembers standing beneath it, his head canted back, gazing intently up and comparing it in his mind with the one he had seen at Longhi's exhibition, the Doria Pamphili version. From his vantage point, several feet below the painting, it appeared almost identical in size and composition. It depicted a naked boy, perhaps 12 years old, partly reclined, his body in profile, but his face turned to the viewer, a coy smile crossing his mouth. Most art historians thought Caravaggio had stolen the pose from Michelangelo, from a nude in the Sistine Chapel, and had made a ribald, irreverent parody of it. From where he stood, Sir Dennis could not make out the finer details. The surface of the canvas was dark, the image of the boy obscured by layers of dust and grime and yellowed varnish, but he could tell that the quality was superb. Then again, so was the quality of the Doria Pamphili painting. He turned to Pietrangeli and exclaimed, "For goodness sake, Carlo, we must get a closer look. We must get a ladder." Waiting for the ladder to arrive, he paced impatiently in front of the painting, never taking his eyes off it. He thought he could discern some subtle differences between it and the Doria version. Here the boy's gaze caught the viewer directly, mockingly, whereas the eyes of the Doria boy seemed slightly averted, the smile distinctly less open. When a workman finally arrived with a ladder, Sir Dennis clambered up and studied the canvas with his magnifying glass. The paint surface had the characteristic craquelure, the web of fine capillary-like cracks produced by the drying of the oil that contained the paint pigments. He saw some abrasion in the paint surface, particularly along the borders where the canvas and the wooden stretcher behind it came into contact. In some areas, the ground or preparatory layer had become visible.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.